So, good morning, everybody. We have a next session here, tutorial about the local government. It's often we think that central government is doing about everything about e-government, and when central government is doing everything, citizens are more than happy. But as you probably, all of you know, the local government is the closest governmental institution to the citizens. So if a citizen having kind of whatever problem he have, he almost, first of all, attending the local government and asking the questions, very simple questions often. I do not have money. I do not have housing. Where my children can go for children daily care? Where is the closest school? Definitely the roles and organization and workload share between the central government, regional government in many countries, local government, it varies very much, the roles and responsibilities. But one thing is similar. It's still the closest government to the citizen. And even more, our citizens often do not know what is the what is local government and what is central government, what is regional government. They do not know. And my opinion is that they even don't need to know it, because for them there must be just one government with the services. And this is the topic what we like to discuss today. What is the role of a local government when we are talking about development of e-government, e-participation, new services, and all the things around it? What is the role of a local government to support the innovation in the field of e-government? How to attract citizens to participate in the co-creation of the new services? The problem is often that we as a government official often think that we know what citizens, what kind of services citizens like to have. And we never ask them, is this the real service what you like? Because we are elected, we are appointed, we are nominated, and we know the truth. I think today citizens know more truth than we do. At least we can discuss about it. We have today four excellent presentations. We start with Julia Glidden. Dr. Julia Glidden coming from London and doing consultancy around the government, the participation in very many countries. And I have a lot to cooperate with Julia in many projects. So the first keynote is coming from Julia. The floor is yours.
Thanks, Hannes. What I want to talk, well, first of all, it's an honor to be here, especially in such a global audience. Many of you in the room have probably heard me speak before, and we've been working together on projects. And it's really nice to sort of expand the ecosystem, as it were, and get the perspective from people from around the world. It's particularly rewarding for those of us that have been working in local government and locally government for so many years to see the topic of local government on the agenda, on an international agenda, and really coming to the fore. Many of you that have worked in European e-government circles for the past few years have known that the European Commission has been focusing on the local level with increased, you know, with an increased level in the last year or two. And I'm really delighted at this UN conference to see it take the stage. And the reason for that really is, as Hannes introduced, the challenges for local government, and not just e-government, local government, are massive. We can't put the radio on, we can't read a newspaper without more doom and gloom. And no matter where you are in the world, there's pressure on government to do more with less. And it's local government that really is in the pincer of that pressure. Because as a mom, I really care if my school is going to be closed, and I want to understand what's happening. And I don't care where the decisions are made, as Hannes had said. I just want to get information about what's happening to my child's education. I want to be able to have my voice heard. I want to understand what the impact is going to be on me. And the first place I will go is my local government. I mean, that's the first point of call that we all have as citizens. It's the place where we're the closest. There's a famous American politician from my home state of Massachusetts who, you know, very famously but very accurately said, all politics are local. And so much in e-government necessarily had to be at a central level 10, 15 years ago when we were just introducing this thing ICT and trying desperately to get government departments to have this radical idea of not just printing big bound green books, which they used to do in New York City when I worked in public administration, but Oh my gosh, put the brochure online. You know, these were big transformational changes, and by definition, we needed to focus at a higher level. But actually, you know, more and more, the level where it really matters and where the pressure is being placed, and those of you that work in local government know this, that in an era in which I can get money out of my bank 24 hours a day, and I still remember going with my mom to cash her check on Thursday afternoons, and when the money ran out on Wednesday, that was it, and we had baked beans and hot dogs on Thursday till she could cash the check again. You know, we live in a 24/7 era where we expect more and more. I can shop online 24/7, I can order my groceries online. I then expect that of my local government at a time when they're getting less and less resource. That's the obvious. But what's the potential answer? Well, we've heard a lot here in the last few days about innovation, innovation ecosystems, co-creation, co-production, collaboration. And you know, I'm curious sometimes how many people really understand what that's about or how you go about it. Or when you're listening, does it feel a little bit like buzzwords? Like, okay, you know, you go back to your office in Tampere or in Tallinn or in London, and you say to your colleagues, we're going to innovate, we're going to co-create, we're going to collaborate. And, you know, they look at you like you're crazy. Because what does that really practically mean, and how do you do it? Is it just something that the Obama administration, with its vast resources, is able to do, and a few governments around Europe have followed? Or is it something that can actually really happen? Well, one of the things that's been really rewarding for me, just in the last 18 months of my career in working with local government, has been the introduction to the Living Lab movement. I don't know if anybody in the room has heard about Living Labs, anybody? A few, but not everybody. It's actually a pretty fascinating common sense approach to helping local government upskill and innovate in a really cost-effective manner. And building on what Hannes said, the idea is really simple. Can you really imagine Microsoft spending $100 million on a new software package and not doing any market research? I mean, can you imagine Nissan putting a new car out and not asking drivers if the steering wheel is in the right place or if the gearbox works properly? The Living Lab movement is just based on the simple idea that if you bring your citizens and your SMEs into a room with your public service designers, you're going to find out what they really want, and you're going to be able to test it through beta and prototype, and by the time you put the service online, you're going to find out that the font isn't too small, the button isn't too hard to push, or guess what? They don't want that service. It's absolutely not what they want. What they want is a school map locator. You know, obviously, I'm a mom with a five-year-old, so schools are my big priority. I want a school map locator to know where I can send my child to school, and then I want those schools indexed to find out which ones have scored the highest, and then I want to know which has the best after-school clubs. But you can't really know that sitting in a city hall. You can't know everything that citizens want. So the Living Lab movement is a methodology that encourages universities, civil servants, small businesses especially, and citizens to work together in the co-production and co-creation of services. And so I'd ask you, when you hear all of these buzzwords, innovation, co-production, just think about the Living Lab as the methodology, a very simple methodology for making that happen. And some of the thinking around Living Labs is that it's a really great way to close the gap between research and development and market take-up. And it's a way to generate innovation in a more cost-efficient and effective way in an era of economic constraint and fear and insecurity. I would say, you know, one of the things that struck me when we heard the excellent keynote yesterday about the amazing things that are happening with the open data movement and the Obama administration, I don't know if anyone else was struck by the statistic. Maybe it's just because I come from the States, but we had 20 countries around the world pick up the open data movement, and only 11 US cities. Only 11 cities in the 300 million people in the United States are actually taking on board the tools of open data and the concepts of co-creation and co-innovation. And my example And my hypothesis is that it's because people just don't know where to begin. They don't have the tools and the methodology at that small local level to do this type of innovation. And it's just kind of taken for granted that it's happening. And my example is when I was in New York City this summer, where I lived for many years, I saw great advertisements on the subway. If you have an application to help citizens get around New York City more, you know, get on www.newyorktransport.com. And I was like, gosh, that's so cool. Then I go back to my small town in Maine, and I literally can't explain to people what I do for a living. They genuinely cannot understand when I say, well, I work to use technology to make government services better. Really? What? Huh? Well, you know, if I tried to say living lab or innovation or co-production, you know, I would just be put on a jargon boat right out into the Maine coastline, and I'd be fishing for lobsters for the rest of my life. It has not... The amazing things that are happening at the national level in the U.S. has not permeated down to the real grassroots local level. The situation in Europe is different, and my hypothesis is in part because of the emphasis that's been placed on living labs. And through living labs, a whole host of new services have been created. This is one service that's been created in the city of Manchester. I've lived in the UK for the last 20 years, so I'm very proud of this. Very simple IoT, Internet of Things, RFID monitoring device in the home that lets you know how much energy you consume. Very simple idea. If I know how much I'm consuming, I might want to monitor my behavior. The other idea is if, in an anonymous way, the city knows how much households in certain neighborhoods are consuming, they'll be able to create better CO2 emissions policy. Really simple. The meters are, I think, €120 to put into a home. Came out of a living lab in Manchester. An urban planning service, I actually really like this one. I think it's kind of cool and whiz-diz and super-duper, but it's a simple idea when you think of what our kids can do with gaming technology now, and yet they're putting a monstrous building up behind my flat in London, absolutely hideous in violation of every planning code under the sun, and we as neighbors got together. And we told the council, you know, you have your duty to consult, and you didn't do it. Oh, well, you know. And we said, well, okay, well, where are the noise studies? How can we visualize what this is going to do to our light? Where's the light impact studies? They put it on at 1 o'clock in the morning the night before the public hearing so we could, you know, and then the system crashed. We went in with our mock-ups, our visualizations. They didn't want to know. Okay, those politicians don't necessarily have the will. But when they made us go to a site visit, and Auntie, I thought of you, they made us go to a site visit one of the coldest winters in British history. You're literally skating on the ice, and your feet were getting frostbite. You had to do this as all the politicians got off their warm bus, and some property developer came, and I kid you not, this is a real story from a year ago, pulled out a blueprint like this and said, see, we're sorry it wasn't on the website, but you can see what this will do. And I said, did you know that in cities like Tampa, they're working really hard so that we can just look online and we can see actually where the shadow is cast and I don't have to trust you, not that I have anything against you, but given you stand to make £10 million and I have to look at this for the rest of my life. And did you know that this noise from the train that I'm worried about, you can actually put a simulation online and I can know that that happens? These guys just looked at me like I was crazy. And the politicians in my local London borough, you know, I'm not in rural Maine, had no idea that there was a way to do this. Now, they might not want that because then they can't hide the documents. But the fact of the matter is they really didn't know. This is a service where in the city of Issy-Moulineaux, right near Paris, it's the ICT hub of France in many ways, you will be able to go online, and if you're going to build a building behind my apartment, it will be up and visualized. But more than that, in kind of 3D world, you'll be able to walk around and tour it and actually experience the building. And then more than that, what the councillors in Brent, where I live in London, would hate, you actually are able to comment on the planning applications, and they will come back and talk to you, and you'll have a dialogue so that you have a better community infrastructure. The last example is a relocation service, and this one is being built for people that want to move to Brussels. Many of you do a lot of work with the European Commission and know that Brussels is one of the cities with the highest relocation rate. And this is one where, you know, it's not just you can visualize your city with Google Map, and it's not just you can find out where the houses are, but you can actually put all of your requirements in. You know, my obsession with schools, someone else's concern about health, a disabled person's concern with mobile access, and actually be able to, in a very real 3D way and a very comprehensive way that extends beyond near a tube and three bedrooms, experience where you're going to move to. Now, these things are great, but if these applications are so great, why don't we hear more about them? Why aren't they happening everywhere? And why is it such a shock to Brent Council, for example? Well, one of the challenges that the European Commission has identified is there's a lack of scalability, that we've had a lot of R&D put into building some really innovative projects, but what's ended up happening is they stay local. So the UC Molino application stays local, and the Manchester application stays local, and the Brussels application stays local, and there hasn't been an ability to truly scale, an infrastructure and a capacity to share these applications, not just the knowledge, but in the era of open government, to actually share the applications. So the Commission has invested quite a lot of time in ENL, the European Network of Living Labs, and it's actually had tremendous growth from just 19 living labs to in the early days to now a total of 274 globally. The greatest concentration, naturally, it's the European Network of Living Labs, but the greatest concentration is still in Europe. But the Commission has been spending quite a lot of resource in expanding the network, and therefore expanding the methodology, and therefore, hopefully, expanding the capacity of local governments to use the Living Lab methodology to innovate, but then expanding the ability to take the innovations from wherever they are created in the world and share them. And I think it's a really exciting initiative. In Europe, the Living Lab and ENL movement has focused on merging future of the internet. Has anybody heard that phrase before? It's the buzzword du jour. It's up there with co-innovation. It actually came before co-innovation, collaboration, and living labs. And it's my frustration at what all the central policymakers have all their buzzwords, and meanwhile, back in the trenches, we're all like, what? But the future of the internet is basically a trend toward using sensors and the Internet of Things and the ability to connect knowledge, like energy consumption. Or, you know, think about this. If you put sensors in bus stops, you'll know where the congestion is, because you'll know that there's 400 people at a bus stop that usually only has 50 people. You'll be able to reroute your bus traffic. If you put sensors in parking spaces, people will be able on their GPS systems to know where to park their car instead of driving around Sheffield, which I used to do month after month after month in my career, looking for parking spaces. It's just about using really simple technologies in very practical ways to make government and our lives work smarter. So the future of the internet, Living Labs, the methodology for getting citizens and businesses and public servants together to create and come up with good ideas, and Smart City. Anybody heard of the Smart City movement? No. That one is a bit, you know, that bunny test where they put the two hands up and you have to decide if it's a bunny or a duck? You know, the Rorschach test? To me, smart cities is a bit like that, because it seems to be everything and nothing to everybody and nobody. And what do I mean by that? Well, I mean, business has figured out that you put the smart label on. So we've got smart cars, smart energy, smart oil, smart green, smart cities. And then it means nothing. It's a marketing ploy. But actually, in the Living Lab policy context, it is about combining Internet of Things, these RFID technology and tools I've been talking about, with Web 2.0 technologies, things that are open and easily downloadable, YouTube, so, you know, Facebook, to help connect city services, to listen to citizens better, to work with them more efficiently, and hopefully deliver more efficient and smart local government services. And the thinking behind the smart city movement is that if you have greater digitization and interconnection of core systems in the city, like transport and air, or water management and energy, you'll be able to use that information to make more intelligent decisions. And I would go back to my Manchester example, intelligent decisions about air traffic and congestion based on where the CO2 consumption is the highest in the city. One of the projects that we're working on through the smart city movement is called EPIC, and you know, I said an EPIC goal, but the thinking is to really tackle head on all of these discrete smart applications that come through Living Labs and then sort of die locally or thrive locally but never have any kind of impact across Europe. And so the thinking behind the EPIC project is to use the cloud to create a kind of app store for applications that get built through Living Labs, and you put them up on the cloud, and then Brussels can download Issy Molyneux's urban planning service, and Manchester can download the relocation service. Now, you know, there's a host of problems with it around procurement, and you know, and the naysayers will tell you there's always a million reasons why they have to reinvent the wheel and have their own thing built from scratch. But the concept is actually quite simple. If you create an infrastructure that's very cost-effective to run, like the cloud, with all the economies of scale with the cloud, you should be able to make services very easy and cost-efficient, and often below procurement rules for cities to buy. So there's some great stuff going on in Barcelona smart city movement around parking. And they were one of the first to create an application that let you pay for your parking via mobile phone. And if I told you the studies of how many times that application has been rebuilt, reinvented, and resold, okay, maybe good for local SMEs, but chances are they're one-shot wonders. And the cities are paying time and time again for this application that's already been built, and they can probably download for, you know, less than €1,000. The thinking behind EPIC is to use the cloud to overcome those challenges. Next project that I think ties in with a lot of what we heard yesterday, particularly with our concluding keynote, is Citadel on the Move. That comes from a statement that local government officials across Europe, including many of you in the room, had signed last December in Ghent during the Brussels presidency and the Brussels conference. And I'm proud of this. It's something I worked on with the Flemish Government Authority to solicit the views of local decision makers across Europe. So we had 61 organizations representing every major city organization in Europe, and then major projects like eCitizen 2 that Hannes is working on that is under the Interreg program, and SEMSD, another FP7 project. So all of the organizations and projects and individuals that work passionately in local government contributed to a statement that said, what do you want national and EU decision makers to do to better support you? And the statement came up with some very common things. You know, help us, one of them being, help us create an infrastructure for shared services. Help us open data. You know, you say open data is good, and then the famous example in Ghent, I don't think it's Ghent, it's Flanders, is they tried to release the railroad schedules. And I want to ask you, try to guess what the answer was from the railroad officials. Oh, if we release the data, people might miss their trains. Try to imagine that it turns out, what if something was wrong in the data and we released it, or somebody reused it wrong and they missed a train? But I mean, the mind boggles at the reasons why the lofty ideals of open data and open government actually don't filter down. So the authors of the Citadel Statement, or the contributors, which is, you know, you local government officials across Europe came up with, was mandate three pieces of data that should be open. Right? Don't just tell us to open data. Just give us three concrete things that you want us to do so we can set an example and overcome those kinds of almost Kafka-esque oppositions. And then the last pillar was citizen participation. I think everybody in this room for the last 10 years has heard, oh, we have to have our citizens participate, we have to hear more, we have to have e-participation, and we've all worked on thousands of projects literally across the union to get citizen participation, but actually when you do try to do it at the local level, it can be much more challenging. And the Citadel authors said, you know, give us some examples of where you want us to go and engage citizens for their feedback. So this particular smart city project was designed to take some of those pillars, and what it will do is create forms and standards and templates that help local government open data, because it's time consuming and it's costly and it's constant. You know, you can release the train timetable yesterday, but then tomorrow it can change. And it's not as easy as it sounds, and it's not as easy as sometimes we make it sound at events like this. So the project is looking at really practical elements that will help local government open data. And at the same time, it's looking to unleash the creative potential of citizens using the Living Lab methodology to help them create the mobile applications that they want. So help moms create a mobile application about the information they want about their schools by helping Brent Council, my council, release the data I need, and then creating mobile application templates so that you don't just need the techies to develop the applications. I would never go so far as to say someone like me could use the templates, because I still struggle to get my PowerPoint going in the right order. But, you know, there's a lot of people out there with basic computer skills, and if you had some simple mobile application templates, they could do tremendous things with that open data. So it's designed to create shared services, because the mobile applications will have RFID and Internet of Things, future of the Internet, to reiterate my buzzword, and there'll be a quiz at the end. But future the internet applications in the mobile templates so that potentially you can share them, so that an application that works in Manchester would potentially be able to work in Issy Moulineaux or in Brussels. These are the cities that I've been working with. But what's happening, Hannes asked me to talk a little bit about, you know, don't just talk about what's happening in Europe, because we all hear so much about that, but what's happening outside Europe. I think one of the most exciting phone calls I ever got was this summer. The president of ENOL called me literally from the Amazon to tell me Citadel on the Move had gotten funding from the commission. And it blew my mind, because I'd heard him tell me a million times at conferences about the Living Lab movement in the Amazon. And I have to say, like, obviously I didn't think he was lying, but I'm not sure I really believed it until I got a call from the president of ENOL in the Amazon, in a living lab, talking to me about the different elements that they're doing in the Amazon, and wouldn't it be exciting if we could take projects like EPIC and Citadel and bring it to the Amazon. And I just thought that was incredibly, incredibly exciting. The next area where ENOL is focusing is in Asia. And Asia, the Tianjin Living Lab is the founding ENOL member, but it's rapidly, like everything else, you know, the Chinese take on board, they take it on board with gust and zest, and they do it remarkably well. So the Beijing City Administration Public Service Innovation has now implemented a Living Lab. The China Mobile Research Institute has implemented a Living Lab. And the Mobile Life Club of China is now working with Beijing University on a Living Lab. And you can see where the movement is going in China. And I would say to those of you in the room, if this movement has spread from Europe to the United States to the Amazon to Beijing, there is something in this methodology of getting your citizens and your SMEs and your public servants together. It doesn't have to cost a lot of money. And using the open technologies and tools that are coming online, such as easy access to open data, such as citizen developers able to create their own citizen applications. And I think it's a really exciting movement. If you were looking at my slide, my city slide, sort of carefully, you'll see that I think, you know, we know the US has living labs. ENOL, it doesn't need to sort of share the knowledge in the US, but you'll see that Africa, Latin America, and Asia are new areas of focus for ENOL, and living labs are coming online there. I'm not usually in the business of predicting, but I've had the privilege of spending quite a lot of time working on e-government in the Gulf, and my prediction is that the next area where we'll see living labs take off is the Middle East and the Gulf region. There are no living labs there yet. And yet, when I look at what's happening in the Kingdom of Bahrain, all the elements of Living Labs are taking place, which is another tribute to how commonsensical the approach is. So Bahrain University, well, the Bahrain government is the first in the Middle East and the Gulf to embrace open data and have a full open data policy and a division within the government authority to release data. They have social media embedded in their 2011 to 2014 strategy. And when I went and visited the University of Bahrain last May, they are now, the government and the university are now working together. And as part of PhD dissertations in e-government, students have to create applications with the data. So in a sense, you see Living Labs happening in this exciting new area of the world, even without the formal umbrella. And I think that that's a tribute and power to the actual methodology itself and our ability to take these buzzwords that we sometimes get killed with at e-government conferences and translate them into real-world practical results. So with my prediction for the future, I think I will conclude blissfully early, Hannes. So I don't know if you want to move on to our esteemed panel or have some questions.
I suggest that maybe we can have a short panel afterwards and questions
great.
And discussions. So save your questions. And thank you, Julia. Thank you very much for inspiring us. And I was told that I didn't introduce myself. My name is Hannes Astok, and I'm an e-government expert from Estonia. I do several projects in together with Estonian e-governance academy and also with Baltic Institute of Finland. So I'm participating in many projects. So and my background is municipal. I have been a deputy mayor of city of Tartu, what is Estonian second largest city. The second presentation is coming from lovely Italian city, Bologna, and my good friend Giovanni Farnetti is working in the Bologna municipality in the ICT department, and he is a keen introducer of new technologies in the city life. And I asked him to give us overview what are the cornerstones when you start to implement e-government in one lovely city like Bologna, but it can be any other. So Giovanni, floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your hospitality. I would like to focus my attention especially on the subtitle of my presentation, how to do more with less money. And it's a typical problem in a local administration. Bologna is in the middle of Italy, so it's in Emilia Romagna. And the middle of Italy means that it's very important for the connection in Italy. What can I say? It's always been on the heads as far as e-democracy project, e-participation project was the second civic network in Europe. But my presentation today will be quite concrete. I will start from real problems for a local administration nowadays. My introduction will be about some lessons learned, and then I will go on with some examples about what we do to following the presentation by Julia to foster the and to enable citizens to co-create application, so abandoning a kind of bottom-up approach. Must say that I feel a bit embarrassed to be here because as soon as I show something coming from Italy or from my city in Estonia, they already did it, and they did it 10 years ago. So this is why I feel a bit embarrassed usually to present it here. I hope that in the end some ministry of Estonia, some Estonian guy will show up. Oh yes, very interesting. We did it in 2005. Anyway, my introduction starts from some concepts that which are very known to you. Which are not very known to public administrations. I speak about public administration, European ones, at least Italian ones for sure. One effect which is the basic for the success of social networks of the business online is the famous long tail effect. So what is important is this side of the tail. So a lot of contributions from a lot of people about also very peculiar topics rather than people asking for the same things altogether. Like, okay, this is just an example related to the songs at Walmart and the songs at Rhapsody or Amazon. So the real business online is in this kind part of the tale. Unfortunately, public administration are always focusing on this side of the tail, so focusing on the same kind of portal of one-stop shop with asking the very same information, but sometimes forgets that the real business out there is on the other side. So my first question is, does your public administration have a long tail? Which means, can you focus on which are the services and data which can be which can have a long tail? I can make you some I don't know, example, like local registry of information of citizens is a typical database, which if you open it, of course, not opening the sensitive data, but if you open it, can have a big business out there. But public administration are very reluctant in doing this. Another problem, well, not a problem, but if you have a look at this table made by Gartner 2 years ago, it's focusing on different kind of application in Web 2.0 that can be wikis, blogs, and podcasts, and so on, focusing on the risk of exposing this kind of application for a public administration. There are some application which have a very high risk from a political point of view. So what is it to say that for a public administration, usually it's very difficult to lose control of information and lose control of the services. And this is not possible nowadays. If you are not capable of losing control on your data and losing control on your application too. My presentation is going towards some concrete example of mobile apps made in my city by the citizens. But if you're not ready to lose control upon that, you're not ready to be on the market and to satisfy your citizens' needs. As a matter of fact, the usual question about open data is that, well, we are a bit scared about using open data because they can use them against us. So this is a typical problem of a politician at a local level when you speak about opening open data, not only missing the train, but even being afraid of citizens using it. Oh my God, I'm losing control. This is, can't go on. And what we should do, as we heard, is to open data, but why? In a concrete way, because people feel they already paid for it, first of all. So if you show people that you open data, they say, yes, of course, you should open data. It's not a question if you have to, because I already paid for it once. And of course, because as we heard yesterday in some lectures, we have an increase in the trust of the local government. Again, let's go further. If we take a snapshot now, we are still probably, as a local administration, building services in a traditional way. It means that we make surveys, we have specification, we ask our providers to develop an application, then we launch the application. Hopefully, we also monitor it, but it's not so common, at least in Italy, to monitor it. But the problem is that the world is changing. Now, our civil servants are on Facebook. So our civil servants are civil servants, but also co-producer of information and sharing information with the citizen. For instance, I tell you a topic, a legal topic in some administration in Italy that probably is also elsewhere, is the usage of the social network by the civil servants. It doesn't mean that they're not allowed to use it inside the administration. No, no, no. When a civil servant is using Facebook, but is not working, so is providing information outside the administration, and it can cause a lot of problems. Should be some policies about this. This is a point I want to raise that can be important. Anyway, let's come back to us. In the future, for sure, This is another slide by Gartner. We are living in the same world, in the same network. So our providers and our followers are the same people contributing in the same application. So what is the key, and I'm connecting to the presentation by Julia, is a creation of information. It's not a top-down approach, but a bottom-up. So you have to allow and to allow citizens to produce their application and to show their needs. Why? Because if in the past we were using internet or we were in the net, now we are the net. We are using social networks. So the situation is like this: there's someone, but a few who are outside the network. But most of us are connected to other people. And this changes a lot the approach, especially for a public administration, because public administration is dealing with the citizens. And the situation is like this. But there are some citizens which are bigger than the others. It means that some opinion makers, some people are more important on the network than some others. So we have to ask them and to involve them in the co-creation of application. So this is to say that networks are not, or social network, it's a perfect example, are not a tool. They are a social phenomenon. We are in that. We are not using Facebook. We are on Facebook or in Google Plus. Networks are not democratic at all. As I showed you before, someone is more powerful and important than someone else. So forget about this kind of idea that the network is democratic and so on. Then in a network, you may not know the identity of the people, but especially you cannot contact them directly. It's typical for a public administration in Italy to open a Facebook fan page and to be proud of it. But if you ask them to contact the citizens, of course, they don't have the email. They don't have, anything but the Facebook account. And if someday Facebook closes your fan page, you don't have any contact with the citizens. So one advice from my administration is to track all the people participating to your fan page on Facebook, for instance, to your website. So to do some kind of surveys or polls or actions to track your people also in your website. Otherwise, you can lose the control upon them. And this is a very nice fact, which I always like to show. It's a calculation made in 2009 about the investment of the European Commission. If you divided it by the number of contribution in e-participation processes, you have the result that every contribution by a citizen costed to Europe 550 euros. So just is to say that probably there's something wrong that has to be focused upon, because if every contribution costed 550 euros, I think it's a bit too much, and you can find the study over here. So coming back to local networks and social networks and local administration, yeah, it's like sex for adolescents. Everybody is proud about it. Everybody thinks about it. Sometimes they do it not very safely. And everybody is spreading their success about social network, even if few had really some. The situation, at least in Italy, sometimes is mostly like this. Public administration are like shouting in an empty square, because citizens are elsewhere. They are on the social network. They are doing something else. They are using the mobile apps. They are not using your administration website. And this is a big problem. So my presentation is focusing on it. And now I'm showing you some some example which can cope with this problem. For instance, very concrete one, citizen relationship management system. It works very well, and so it allows people to make some alerts. These are some statistics. What is the key again for us now is integration on Facebook. So there is another public administration in Italy, Rimini, which is using Facebook as a CRM. So the same fan page is used for tracking the alerts by the citizens. And another kind of application, real application I want to show you, and I have also here, is Hyperbole. Hyperbole was the civic network and is a civic network of Bologna, is known around Europe. It was the second civic network in Europe back in 1995. What we did is that we asked the citizens to contribute in building an application for the iOS world, but we are thinking now about a framework to have also for other platforms, for Android and so on. The key points are, first, co-design with the citizen. So involving the citizen like in a living lab from the beginning of the application till the end, without abandoning them. Another good idea we had is a competition about citizen. They're doing the same in Amsterdam, for instance. We saw it last week. To make citizens compete with their application and give prizes to the best ones. Of course, open data is the basis for this kind of application. What is important are some courses, some trainings, some education initiatives about how to build a mobile app. It's very. I'm sure if I offer you a course about it, most of you will participate, because now is on the top of the agenda to be allowed to develop your app on your own and to publish it and to have the revenues back. Okay, it's very important. And as I told you, also to have a common framework for multiple operating systems. Last but not least, to release the code in open source GPL's license. So the code, of course, we are producing. The code, of course, the app is published, but the code can be released in an open source framework. This is the app. I wanted to show you connected to the iPad, but it's here. And for instance, it's very nice that you can do, signal a problem shooting a photo. So you can shoot a photo and then you attach it to your message. And then you can write all your problems and send it to the administration. So, of course, you also have some other features like information from the administration about new initiatives and films and so on. This is just the first example. We believe in it. We believe in the co-creation with the citizens of this kind of mobile apps. And we have also to thank the Citizens Project, because what we learned was also thanks to this project, which is a project of exchange of best practices at the European level. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Giovanni. Excellent presentation and really kind of initial roadmap how to start the co-creation with the citizens. But we have one city already in the world who is doing a lot of co-creation with the citizens. And as Giovanni presented us, a lot of nice ideas, there must be also a systematic approach to do it. Otherwise, you are just doing it in one day, but forgetting it for next 343 days. So this must be, I think, also systematic. The city is Tampere from Finland, and they do excellent work on it. And Antti Leskinen is head of local democracy unit in the city of Tampere, and he is responsible for the, I don't know, are you responsible for all democracy in Tampere? Or
developing it.
Just developing Tampere, democracy, not...
The advanced, but I don't have to do it all myself.
Yeah. Okay, so, floor is yours. Yeah. Probably need to switch off the mic.
Okay.
In, up. Yep,
right, yes. Thanks. Okay, it's an honor to be here. Giovanni already said that he's within participating in eCitizen 2 project, and we are always with that project. We already was in the first one. That was a very good project, and we developed some of the systems that we have now within that project, but some of later on that. little bit of Tampere, if you don't know it. A little bit over 200,000 people. Just like Bologna, a hub of a railroad and roads in Finland. Also a university and technical universities there. We made a big change a few years ago, and this is very important for citizen participation. I think this is vital that we have such systematic approach in there. There are three pillars in our new system of governance. First of all, the first politically elected mayor in Finland. A multiple provider system of services, so we use also NGOs and associations to provide services in a much wider way than other cities in Finland. And the third one, this is unique in Finland, the third pillar is development of public participation. That's why we have a 7-person unit of there. And that's why the top management is obliged to further local democracy, including direct participation of the residents. What do we mean by direct participation? It's a here closer interaction between political and official decision makers, officials and residents. And we mean in practice that individuals and groups like associations have possibilities to get information, to participate and to influence on city plans and decisions. This is not a presentation that everything is fine in Tampere. You know, we are just developing it, but we are building the channels, and I show some of the channels right now. But as you see, we started this already on 2003. And why this? Why do we have such systems and 7 persons to developing it? In Finland, there's a overall thinking that openness of planning and decision making is an important aim of good governance. And just to get more ideas from the people. When we think of the people in Tampere, there are many professionals that could help enormously our planning and preparing of decision. And their ideas are very valuable. And just ordinary people, they know their areas very well. Why should we put expensive consultants to see there what is good for them? Sustainable development, it includes, of course, public participation. And down there are also the laws in Finland that say we have to have direct participation, but they don't say in practice how to do it. Sometimes it's good because we have a lot of freedom to do it, but sometimes you wait that there would be more backup from there, from the ministries. Okay, as I said, the top management has to further direct participation, and in a concrete way, I always get 15 minutes from the top managers when I want to discuss with them. And I discuss with them in the lunch table, and they ask me, so the Tampere is, I think the power of that administration is that it's discussing. It's not the same way when I have been giving lectures in other cities that they sometimes say that the top management is far away from the middle management or practical planners. Okay, we'll develop it to a standard procedure. And our unit, we are, our responsibility is to develop tools for officials, practical tools to do it. Arrange training, that's what we are not good right at the moment, but we are trying to do it, and of course cooperate with other units. Okay, the main tools. We have the Valma Forum. Some of you took the paper down there, if you wish, it's on the table. We have local advisory working groups that I'm explaining in a minute. Open meetings, nowadays five times a year between top politicians and between residents. Representatives of youths in city council this year, and two city committees, and children's council once a year. These are just the main tools. We have been talking a lot about electronic participation, but I think this is a wholeness. You have to have also direct meetings with the people. Some of the people don't work in internet, and definitely they don't look at the city pages. So we have to take the issues to the people, also to, for example, the older peoples that are mainly represented in these advisory working groups. But we have four of these in every area of 40,000 people, and one group in that's working mainly in internet in the city center, but that's just starting this year. 55 members in each group. You understand that such a group can not work effectively, so we have subgroups, for instance, for traffic or youth issues or whatever is important there in that area. About 25 meetings a year, and the only people that in a city that cannot be permanent members are politicians in city councils, because we thought it's not a good thing to mix representative democracy with direct participation. I don't know if we are right, but that was our decision too. And each group has a planner of our unit to support them, because the group needs to be organized, and someone needs to be between the administration and the people to get the message through and to take the issues down to the people and explain what the issues are, and to be sure that the people understand the thing right. Here, a picture of a joint meeting of three such a group, and as you can maybe see, we don't have official meetings, you know, such formal meetings, but work is done in ways of group working systems. So there are people putting papers on the wall and writing their issues, and then in a systematic way we go through all the issues. If there are 100 people and sometimes 100 angry people, you don't, in a big meeting, you cannot handle it properly. But within groups of three, for instance, it's much easier. First we develop and collect the questions, for instance, put the main issues on the walls, and then go through in a systematic way. That person was before in a voluntary group, and then came to one of the planners in our unit. Okay, then about Valma. One of the things that I find important is that there are many. Valma is not a big invention. There are many such systems that put city issues on comments. But the special thing is that the city officials have to put or have to use Valma. So it's not voluntary. It's integrated in the into the city management system. And everyone, including you, is free to browse through all official documents and other people's comments. The only limitations to you might be that it's in Finnish, but anyway, you can look at all official documents that are related to that issue. So, in a way, open data, but it's not, of course, not in a such manner that you can manipulate it. And when people put comments on Valma, they are going directly to the decision makers and officials that are in charge. You don't have to register when using Valma, but if you do, you get some services there. You can get directly short city electronic newsletters, like in that street we are renovating it, or there's a plan to renovate a park or something like that. There might be issues that are present right now or coming in a month. And you can choose the issues. You can put ticks on, like, I want issues that concern the city center or the western area, if I'm interested on that, or if I'm interested on sports, culture, land use planning, then you get just those messages from the city. So it's sort of a watchdog for the inhabitants. You can use a nickname, but you have to give contact information, but it only goes to the moderator in the city communications unit. And the units have to report to us the use of Valma, and we report to the city council each year. So we are a little bit following up the use. Of course, we have land use planning that's it's obligatory in Finland to do a participation and impact assessment plan before you start planning an area. So has to be opened up. It's in the internet, and in the city hall you can see it, and you can say that, okay, we want more participation possibilities in the net, or we want meeting in place there so that the planners show us what is going to happen. So you can influence the planning process also, which I find very important. And the units, of course, arrange hearings, workshops, TIS systems. So that what I'm presenting is here just the main tools that we are using. Then challenges. People don't know Valma. If you go to Tampere and ask what is Valma, they don't know it. We have only under 1,000 registered people. We have to take where the internet tools where people are. They don't go to see city pages. They don't doing something else in the internet. So we are planning on big interactive information tables that we go and take to the markets and libraries and things like that. Officials don't have training on public participation in Finland. And that's a big problem. So architects, engineers, they have to do it without training. And this is different in other European countries. And if some unit develops a good tool or system, how do we know it? In a city in Tampere, we have 15,000 employees because we have schools and other systems within our administrations. How do we know it? And also, if other cities in Finland develop good tools, how do we know it? We don't have good networks within that. And that's why various units don't perform at the moment in the same way. So people don't know what to expect. And on the red, I put there creating trust between residents and the city organization is the main aim, I think. And that we don't yet have. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Antti, for this very systematic overview of systematic approach you provided us. So I think it's like lesson learned what everybody can follow, and the presentations are definitely available for you in the website. So our last presentation is going back to the same approach what we just discussed. It's a systematic approach, because you can develop and co-create a lot of services together with the citizens, but when you're starting to provide them, you must be systematic. The problem is in electronic world, comparing to the ordinary, so-called ordinary old-fashioned office, that if in old-fashioned office there are like 10 officials sitting next to each table, and they do not know how to handle the problem, they're just asking from each other and deciding when today we are making this process in this way and making decision in this way. But computer, when we put the process to the computer, computer do not know. Computer cannot ask from the next computer how I solve this problem. So that's why we need to define the processes. And city of Tallinn, capital city of Estonia, our host city today, has taken this long and painful path to map all the public services what we are providing. Because as it became, as we understand that there is no clear description about the services, what they do. Mr. Thomas Sepp is city secretary, head of city office, the highest public official in the city government, and he's leading this process. And I'm happy Thomas is here to explain you what is the process and what is this long, long way. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, I apologize for some mistakes in presentation, but nevertheless, and we heard theoretical aspects of involving local governments and these people to democracy or participation processes, but I'm not talking today about everything what we have done in Tallinn, and we have done a lot, document registers and so on. About this, who are more interested will listen tomorrow. 11 o'clock we have a study tour to city government. But now I am going to tell you about one project what we started because of life demanded it. And this is about our services. And believe it or not, usually if we are asking from our staff members, what are your services? What kind of services you are providing? And 2 years ago I got answer, I have a lot of them. So when I asked, what exactly? When they said, we have a fees a little bit and that a little bit. So that wasn't answer what was good to me. So we decided to map all our services, and starting with approximately 2 years ago, and there are lots of IT work what was done, but much more administrative work, including training what is ahead, and including all the publicity work what we have to done, have to do this year, next year, and so on. And I am not telling you already we succeeded in this or not. Our project in the final stage now, we're starting with it probably from the 1st of January next year, but at least I am describing you what we have done. Our city is comparatively same like Bologna, so we can cope. And we have 13 departments, plus city office, plus city district offices, plus city council office. So each of them are, like you know, a small kingdom. Try to keep something for themselves, not delivering with others. But what we started to do to broke these barriers, and I think one method is to make this project successfully, what we are going to tell you. First steps, we're trying to define what kind of services we really have. And firstly, what is a service? And believe me, we had a really hard discussions. Is it service at all or not? It's just something. What is service? And when, for example, in this parking ticket, is it service or something different? And when we studied a little bit theory and set our own ideology, and we found that there are two kind of types of services, direct services and indirect services. Direct services like application request, whatever. So we thought this is clear. And there are indirect services, we have to keep streets in good shape, our greenery and so on, street lights. Everybody using these services, but this is not exactly to me, it's for everybody, it's also for me. So, and when we started to like what kind of service types we have, and we found it that we have information, we have some basic services, allowances, permits approvals, fees payments, this is which paid to city budget, and some registration. Of course, if you're doing the same thing, you can you might find other types or other theories. We took this division. So this picture is not unknown for you. It's five levels, five E levels. Theory, and going through these all levels, we looked for our services and said how much of each type of services we really have today. And of course, we are going to find much more and as much as possible and as much as needed, the fifth level services. And what we also did, we prioritized the services, because there are lots of different things you can do in electronic way, but some of them are just having, especially in our case, so few customers, and that's not effective. So you have to look, is it good? Or at least it's not good to start to, from fees. So
the red digits is the customers or the price?
No. How many services are in that level? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And coming back to this lack of customers, this is Estonian problem, especially in small municipalities and also in our case. In beginning of this year, we listed and we had to somehow group these services. We found 20 service fields. We found 570 services. And tomorrow that might be 556 or 675. We have to follow all the processes all the time. And what we also have done, this is, and this is crucial, when we try to put some people, get some people possibility to pay for the services, we have to connect this system somehow with our financial management system, with our SAP. And when we, and that was again big challenge, somehow to compare the service names and the articles in price lists of our department services. And somehow we even did that. That was a big job. And of course we listed all these services and subservices in our website. And of course to make this position, our position stronger, we also made a statute, improved it into city council, so no one from department side can say, I'm not interested in your work. How it looks in our website, this is a service fields, and there are 20 of them, and let's say, let's go then to the next slide. This is we see that we have a service subfiles. These are something 100 something, and when we have a services 570, and when we have this SAP system, price articles. What is price article? Is for example, if you rent some sport room in our school in evening times, what are price? And for example, one price may be from 8 to 10, and another in Saturday or whatever. Everything, every of these is a price article. What we also have to clarify for themselves, who is a service owner? And service owner is one of our departments, always one of our departments. If you could try to put, like politicians sometimes like to give some job not to the departments but to some advisors, to a mayor, to a deputy mayor, to whoever. In that time, in that case, you sometimes will not be successful because you don't have a support of department and knowledge. And service providers are certain people in our departments. Service provider might be also some private company when we outsourcing some services. All information about this service, if even it's provided by a private partner, is on our website. And of course, in our website there are everything about application channels. There are different channels. Electronical way is just one of them. And legal acts. We put links to our legal acts register, to state legal act register, so everybody can check in details how these service have to be provided. And here is some picture about service information. You see here is some our kindergarten contacts, how to apply a place in for your child. Of course, in our we have a deficit on this at the moment, but at least you can apply. And what we have done, it's a birth registration service card. We made this easier for the parents, not leaving home, they can apply. It's an online service for birth registration. And of course, we provided there some introduction video, if you like. We don't have a time now, but you can look at this later. And this service is a card also from our web page linked to Estonia EE portal. Also asking from feedback for citizens, from citizens, and this is a problematic. We don't let people just to vote in our web pages because some comments are not polite. So some administrators will take and send them to others to clarify, and we will later on get answers in one place of most important questions, so we'll do this. This is a feedback forms, where they are all in our website. You can write it there. We established also service standards, and I even don't think you can see what were, and but this is just an example how we are describing the processes. Every process is described in one methodology, and where are excluding information type of services, this is not necessary. But all the processes we have to map, especially when we took over this ideology of a service hall. You will see it tomorrow if you like. In that case, you also have to re-engineer your workflows. And we did also this. And that was coordinated by the city office, by the same office, to do it by the same methodology. And what's the staff who is doing that? We have two persons in my office who are centrally coordinating, but and we have of course 40 people, maybe more even, from different top department levels who will provide one or who are responsible of one or another service. So and they will make this administration accessible only formulas. They will do this back office job. And what we are planning also by this project, it's let people pay for the services via our web page, and they have also link to the service to pay for the service via bank accounts. And you can enter to this with ID card or via bank accounts. This is just one example how you can pay by yourself and having no bill. And what we also doing, we linking these services into city map. We make a pictures from all the places where you can get this service, and it all will be in the service side. It's a picture like it will be. And also what we're doing with mobile text messages, especially reminding that bills are not paid. And the next also to prioritize some things and to get some opinions, but in our financial aspect first, is more important for us. And some statistics not going to tell about this more. And conclusions, we have now clear administration rules, integration of other city databases and systems. There are some kind of centralization needed, strong supervision and constant development with staff. And if you like to hear more about our experiences, and we have also a development training center, which will give you some expertise, will be your partner. Thank you. Sorry about some time.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's really valuable work what you do. Before we start the discussion, we have a report about the workshop, and Kristina Reinsalo is working as a program director of a local government in e-governance academy. Kristina, you can use this. And she's also doing research research in Tartu University about the same topic. So what you learned? What we learned? Yeah, tell us what we learned.
As a first thing, I have to say sorry for my voice, because I have been talking here during this conference for 2 days constantly.
We have the same problem.
Non-stop, so please, I'm really feeling sorry. But yeah, I'm from Tartu. So that's why during summing up here, what we have been talking here, I'm coming with some examples from my city, because at the same time I'm feeling sorry that you visit here in Estonia, probably first, I hope not last one, will only be here in Tallinn, because Tartu city is worth of visiting. So my examples or connections to this theory and nice talk we have been heard here are connected to this. I would like to start with really intriguing topics like co-creation and living labs and smart cities. But I think what we heard here, the core thing is actually first thing I would like to point out is change of organizational culture when doing this, when starting all this participation, e-participation thing. So I think that's why, like what Thomas has been presented, of course what Antti has been presented is very relevant to start. So change of organizational culture, because it really requires huge change in mentality of local governments people. I think Giovanni raised very nicely also this important question when it comes to open government really in local level. Are we as local governments officials, municipalities, ready to lose control over the data? I think it's very, very important question. Are we ready to see that citizens or companies are not using it in a way against us, but they surely can make just one part of our job instead of us actually using this data, offering us some new services we even haven't dreamed about it before. So my example coming from City Tartu is there were actually procedure, like normal procedure, I think in all governments is the same, that they have detailed planning in city government, and there are in some districts they have to cut some older trees and so on. And this, of course, all this information is available, it's online, and but these citizens living in these districts, actually they are getting, of course, an official announcement of city government when it is decided that these trees will be cut down. So, but what happened in Tartu, that this data was open before citizens living there in these districts got this announcement official. But business sector companies who are providing service of cutting trees got this data already, like it was open data already on web pages. So they already contacted the citizens before city government's official announcement was there. And so there was accusement to city government about corruption, that how some companies know having this information. Actually, it was open data, so it just shows you that we have to react very quickly as local governments. Really, we we should probably communicate it in Facebook at the same day or tweet about it. So it's and now. So I think it's absolutely crucial question Giovanni raised here. Social media, again, Giovanni raised it, and it has been risen during this conference constantly. As much we need general rules and guidelines for participation, that every official knows exactly which topic may provoke public interest, and I think that we use the use of social media must be regulated. I'm not thinking about like strict regulations or any more papers about regulating, but I think special guidelines for every single organization, like very simple in very very handy way, like probably online manual of just couple of most important things, really, because at least what I'm seeing here in Estonia, that many officials using social media, there are very many officials using social media actually, but their roles there are mixed, so sometimes they presenting views of local government, sometimes their personal views, so it's they are a little bit, I think that they are a little bit confused using it. It's still so. It must be somehow helped them. So it's I mean by these guidelines, just helping them. And in very many cases, local governments are in social media already as institutions as well, but they don't link it to the official website. So according to my personal surveys we have done here in Estonia, that if you are entering to official webpage, you even can't see any linkage to social media. Actually, if you are heavy Facebook user, you know that they are actually in Facebook. But if I'm just trying to get in closer relationship to my local government, I don't even realize it from official website that they are actually in social media. And again, as I said, one very nice example coming from my city Tartu, using Twitter. Actually, they were preparing a new tender for getting new solutions for public transportation. Solutions, I mean everything about design of buses in Tartu, about new bus stops, new shuttles, and so. And the main communication channel actually they used was Twitter. So, and they got so much feedback. So it means that if it's really topic which touches so many citizens, they come. Say it's very easy to find way to them via social media. But of course, at the same time, this same case study showed that, of course, that contribution is more like they just want to play, of course. If they were not commenting so much about, I don't know, bus stops or something, but the most, they were most active on choosing different colors of buses and so, of course, because they are human beings, they want to play. So, but I think we have to offer them opportunities to play. So, and now I'm coming to my last point or aspect I said I would like to start with, but I think first two are important as well. So all this co-creation thing and labs and everything, it's so inspiring. So I think most important thing we have to think is that it is done what is needed and in a playful way, really. I think we have to deal in local governments also with terms coming from business sector, from marketing. There is no, we can't skip this concept, because I don't think they will be our very far future. I think they are just tomorrow, like a concept experiential economy. I think that we have to consider that this is not so far future, really. I mean by that in local government concepts that we have to offer our citizens memorable experiences, to offer them in places where they are not expecting them, and in a way they are not waiting this. This is not just marketing thing or branding thing anymore. I think we have to to think the same, we have to provoke loyalty. I think we dream about to be our citizens loyal to us, so we need to give them inspiration, really. This inspiration part is really important. And last thing I would like to mention, it's related to this, the same experience economy, and again marketing term like welfare technology. I think in ancient Europe, with loneliness and people living in isolation, at the same time being connected constantly 24 hours, but at the same time being probably more lonely than ever, I think even in local government context, we have to think about that robots and all these kind of things are not so far from us anymore. So even if we can think what in local government level, social healthcare or social things it may mean that there are some older people living alone, but having like robots to just to be with them, but at the same time having sensors giving to us information how they are doing what. So I don't think it's so far from us anymore. So I would like to just to stop to finish with slogans that I think we are as a net, as Giovanni said, and I think every single local government must be labs, so there are no different living labs anymore. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Those conclusions. And now I'm asking all participants to come closer to here and then sit down, and we have now time for a few questions and comments. So please be seated. And I hope you're not leaving us. Okay, very good. You can take the mic. So please, Christina. So please, now we have time for questions and comments. Probably you already collected a lot of questions and comments during the answer. So please, can we have a microphone? Yes, yes, please. Okay, good.
Yeah, hello. Question about Tallinn. Is the e-service catalog and technically the infrastructure integrated to the Estonian X-Road and the Estonian country e-service catalog?
Yes, of course.
In what way?
Identification goes through that. But from the other hand, also talking about our payments, what we like to do later on, you can identify yourself also via bank accounts, but answer to your question is yes.
So it's a complex system, and municipalities can utilize the government systems, and government is also sharing the information necessary for the municipal services. So you retrieve part of information already from the government databases. So we're trying not to, we are not allowed either, to duplicate the same data in the government registers and municipal registers. Either it's sometimes happening.
In our case, in our state, we have much more services provided by the municipalities than to the with state authorities. So that's why we are very keen to put all these to also link to a state portal. But we are not doing this on behalf of us. We have to do this, we have to link that.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Next question, Will.
Okay. A quick question both to Bologna and also to Tampere. Okay. In Bologna, your Hyperbole app you described reminds me very much of Love Clean Streets in Lewisham. Is that right? You know it probably. You know, where people can, on their mobile phone, take a picture of something wrong in their community, yes, and send it in. But the interesting thing in Lewisham is also that this tends to, not, I think it goes direct to the street workers who use it to organize their own work schedule. So it's not going to someone in the town hall who then writes it out and gives it to them. They don't even have to come to the town hall. So it actually is quite fundamentally changing the way the council workers are working, giving them more independence, as these are, you know, often quite low-educated people, giving them more independence, able to work their own work schedule and be much more efficient. So I wonder whether, my question is the same happening in Bologna on that. But in Sampere, sorry, the question was, when you showed the physical meetings, it was all old people, the picture.
Youngsters on Facebook.
Yeah, well, that's my question. Do you have any socio-economic profile of the participants in the physical meetings compared with the online? And I expect it will be. That was quite interesting to catch the different ages.
Yes.
Giovanni?
I'll answer first. Your question is very interesting, and the answer is a bit complex because I have to disagree that upon the point that if the municipality is not answering, at least in Italy, you don't have someone who will take care of it. So someone has to put face on it, and the face has to come from the municipality who has, who is in charge of fixing, for instance, a road problem. For instance, we have a kind of portal for all these kind of problems all around Italy, and it's not working because people don't trust it, because they see that they make they signal a problem, but nobody's taking care of it practically. So we believe that alas, we have to put someone. Someone has to put the face on it, and it has to be the municipality. But what I showed you that in Estonia probably they already did it 10 years ago is not that. I mean, the service is quite simple and not revolutionary. What I wanted to stress is that the app is co-created with the citizen, and it's just the first example of what can be. It's not that which is revolutionary. It's that it's a mobile app, and it's made by the citizens with our help and education. So this is, my point.
Antti, that was a question for you.
Yeah, you have a sharp vision to see that. Yeah, we have actually statistics that the main age is about 55 years in these groups, or a little bit less. And that's why we are developing a system for an electronic e-system to support these Alvare groups, these area groups. And that's we have to do it, because younger people are in the internet, and people with children don't have the time to come in the evenings there.
You need both, clearly.
Yeah, we need both.
But my question is, have you been, probably you have been thinking also that you can somehow connect the live meeting and the internet presence in the way that you can broadcast the meeting to the internet, and people who cannot attend physically can probably share their comments through Facebook or Twitter on the same time. So
yeah,
it will be like one room,
yeah,
virtual plus real.
Yeah.
And I think it would motivate more people just to see their relatives or friends participating physically, so it would be like plus motivation.
We are coming to that.
Yeah. Thomas?
And just a comment. We heard about Twitter, Facebook were much other channels. Some cities putting these into their websites. But my question is, who can administrate them? What kind of sources you have of that, and you have to somehow apply to answer to these things. And I think that is a challenge why we are not doing this at the moment. We don't know what will happen in small towns. That's probably possible, but in bigger cities, I think you need to have much more staff for that.
But as we said, there is a great sample from city of Tampere. They have, as we heard, 7 persons working as a staff, and they also having politically elected mayors in your city. So maybe you just need to add more staff, and so it's a question of priorities. Actually,
we have seven. We need some 20. When I will ask when city council, I will say, "Are you stupid?"
Okay, next question, please. Where is Danvar?
My name is Norbert Kersting. I'm professor in comparative local politics and working now in Germany, but I was working 5 years in South Africa, and there I focused more on the global south. And actually, there are trends which are globally. From the 90s, you can see a trend on new public management all over the world in different cities. And now you had also a trend towards more participation. I think that got a new push now with the idea of open innovation. I have one question for Matti and one for Julia. There is one rule when it comes to, I mean, I think there one solution is really to go for a combination of internet solutions and advisory boards which are meeting. But there is one rule which always says you should include. I mean, you said you excluded the administration and the politicians from your advisory boards. The problem is if you exclude it, you may be in a context which is safer for the civil society, but it's always more difficult to transfer the results to the administration and back to the politician and the political party. So the trick is include them, but don't let them sit on the driver's seat. That is, I think that is a very tricky thing, but it is a good idea. The other question, Julia, living labs, I mean, there is a trend now going towards participatory budgets. There is a trend towards the living labs. I remember in the 90s we had hundreds of different types and labels for participation. Is this the one participatory budget more focusing on the budget? Is a living lab more focusing on the town planning and the into that field? I think it's a good idea to have one or two labels only. Otherwise, we think we have only a few experience, but there are plenty of experience worldwide.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. Maybe Antti, you give first comment, and then Julia.
Sure. You're quite right, and I forgot to mention that actually all the meetings of these groups are open to everyone. But you can just be official member, not being a politician. But the politicians can come to every subgroup meeting and to every meeting, so they're really open, and all the papers that are produced by the reports are also open, and they go to the decision makers when the decision is made, for instance, in the city council or the committees. So you're quite right, and we're
so
it's a mix sort of.
Okay, Julia.
Julia, before you answer my question related with the living lab, so yeah. I prefer, let me also ask and then you answer together. So about the living lab, how is overall architecture in your mind? Because the government divided as the central government and then province government and the county government and also big city. Inside of the big city also has a district government, and then middle city and small city and the countryside. So there are totally so many local governments. And what's the overall architecture of the living lab design in your mind? I would like to hear.
Okay, yeah. So your question really goes back to something we talked about in CREM's Excellent E-Democracy Conference in May, and I would urge you to go, because we had a discussion where I actually said I think e-democracy seems a bit outdated. We started with e-democracy 10 years ago when e-voting was the big tool, and this will come back to participatory budgeting. E-democracy 10 years ago was e-voting, the tool to let people vote more easily. And then people said, no, we need to hear more views about politics 365 days a year, not election day. We all start to about e-democracy. And then social media tools came on board where we could engage with citizens and civil servants could engage with citizens and citizens could engage in policy making. And participation became much more of an umbrella word. And I think the evolution really has gone in line with the technology and what technology has enabled, and then some of our shifts in thinking. So one of the tools that has come out of this shift to e-participation, from this kind of tool of e-voting to this broader e-participation, is a tool like participatory budgeting, which allows citizens to more actively engage in day-to-day decision-making, not just vote for somebody one day, but have ongoing discussions and feedback with the council about things that matter to them, like do we want to shut the library, which is happening in parts of Britain, or close, you know, the after-school care. You know, really hard budget decisions, and that's the tool of participatory budgeting. Now, living labs, in a sense, takes the tools and the shift in focus on participating and working with citizens that the tools has enabled, and what it is it's a methodology. And I have to admit, when I first heard about it, José Gricar, brilliant, we call him Mr. Slovenia in my world, just this brilliant visionary academic in Slovenia around e-government. And he first talked about living labs at a conference I ran in Budapest, and I thought he was crazy, and I had to write the proceedings, and I just couldn't get my mind around this. What is this? We're having high-tech labs and whiz kids gadgets everywhere. And I really struggled, and I wrote the writings. You know, I have to go back and read what I actually wrote about what he said. And then it just clicked. It's a methodology for using these tools that have just exploded onto the scene that we couldn't even anticipate 10 years ago, right up to open innovation and open data and mobile applications, so that we can, yes, have citizens engage in discrete things like budget making, but in much broader things like service delivery and service design. And do that analogy. I just think if you just, I used to work in marketing, no private sector entity would approach creating new products the way government has traditionally done it. And there's all kinds of reasons why, so I'm not bashing government and, you know, putting the private sector on a pedestal. It just, it's so common sense. If there's a methodology that allows you to use these tools of social media to create what citizens really want and need, and not have to put it online and get it wrong and realize they don't use it and then, you know, go back to the drawing board. So that I, to your question, I would distinguish between the tools and then the methodology, between discrete things like budget making and the broader concept of service delivery. Now, in terms of the architecture, or at what level? In theory, living lab methodology can work at any level. I think in practice there are geographical limitations. I use the example of Bahrain or even Estonia. Smaller countries, you can have a methodology that can work on a national level. If you go to a place like the United States or China, you really have to drill down much more locally to have any impact. And again, yesterday, it just struck me so viscerally, almost, listening to my American compatriot talk about these amazing things that are happening in the U.S., and yet as somebody that goes home really regularly, I never hear about it. Nobody I know hears about it. And as I said, I can't explain my job to anybody I know in America. If I said open data, they don't have a clue. You know, I really can't. So it depends on the size of the political entity and then what you're trying to achieve. But really, Living Labs is about going local, really going down and getting people in their real lives where it really matters, working together for the services that they really want.
Thank you, Julia.
Another question goes to Tallinn. So two details. I want to know, you said in the future, if you want to provide any service, you have to follow in the service standards.
Yeah.
And is that the standards described in the UML language, Universal Model Language, or free style? So I just see some model. I don't know whether it's described in the UML or something else.
I have to apologize. But the question is too difficult for me, as is technical details.
But who make this standard?
We have here our ICT director, Wayne Olev. He will answer shortly.
Yeah.
Anna, put the microphone.
Okay.
Yeah. Can we have a microphone, please? Sorry? Oh, okay. Yeah. What does it?
About the standards, we are not talking about the technical standards. We are talking about the standards, how the service will be available good for people good. And also we are talking about the standards good, how you can get it through a website or directly from some of service points and etc. Technical standards for our case good. We are not fixed any technical standards for good, only good like interchange information between systems good. If you are taking, for instance, sample about the Tallinn city all information systems. We are developed by very different vendors, good, and we never have set up for them good. You have to put or develop with service on certain way good, or using certain hardware or software good. Never. We are talking only, okay, you have to have interoperability. Interoperability between local services and state-level services or federal services. And if you know good about the European interoperability framework, this is matching also those requirements. So we are asking only people, you would like to use your iPad, or you would like to use your Apple computer, or you would like to use any other computer. Would you like to use a web browser, Internet Explorer, or Mozilla Fireworks? Whatever, good. You have to get this service. This is the main principle here. Good. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, is that even some of the guidelines?
Yes.
Absolutely. But okay. If you are talking about the real technical standards on exchange information, this is another way. Yeah. Okay.
Another okay. question there is okay. You see service feedback. Service feedback.
When you think about the service feedback, yes, someone already sent it to you, and then how is the little work? You arrange how many persons to collect, to do the statistic and pick up some important words, and how to do it later on?
Up to now, as I showed in a picture, we have two administrators in this central level, and they will still dealing with this. Later on, if services are in our website all described, and where we have a responsibility, we have a owners of these services by the departments, they will answer there, and if there will be some questions asked for 10, 20, 30 times, they will make then a question and answers section, and that will be put to this service description.
Okay. Okay. So another question goes to the Finland. So you say that you involve many persons to participate this e-government, and how do you handle those the different opinions, sometimes contradiction or conflict each other, and although you listen, you hold some grouping meeting and so on, so hardly to reach the common agreement, for example, set up a nuclear power station or set up the garbage treatment factory nearby your home, so how can you handle such things?
Okay.
Of course, there are difficult big issues that have contradictions. These Alvari groups, we don't expect that they have a unique common mind, sort of. So everyone can put their own comments to the administration. And we don't shift power from the city councils to the groups. That's, of course, clear. The power stays in the city council, and they listen. They hear all the comments, and then they make decisions. And, of course, the people want to get their say directly to the politicians. And that's also possible. And it's just a matter of discussions. We take time, and then they make decisions. And if they are not right in 4 years, they will be kicked out. That's democracy.
Council still that's decides, and this is just recommendations for council members.
It's a consultation.
Yeah. Nothing more.
That's right.
It's a consultation process.
Yeah.
So we have time for very last question.
Thank you for the last question. I am also from Tallinn City Office, and one of my responsibilities are public services. And because that, I followed very carefully representation from Bologna, because there are much common, there are quite the same architects and database, and there are much common in built up the system. And my question, I think I understood you correctly, that you put your database into Facebook. Why it was done so? What are your hopes and what are the results? Maybe I didn't understand you 100% correctly, but anyway, that was my understanding.
Yes, what we are doing is to shifting our CRM system into Facebook. It means that citizens can talk to the administration via via Facebook. Another project is opening our database for building apps. So I showed you two examples, but one dealing with social media, the other dealing with mobile apps. They are both examples of, in our opinion, the future trends. We are going there. We are going there into opening in Facebook. On Facebook, we have one person interfacing and understanding you. Yeah, we don't have budget at all, but this person is very young and is taking also, sorry to say, but it's free time to be there. Mm-hmm. Because what I wanted to say that people are in the network not only when they're working, okay? And this could be a huge resource because they have benefit from it. They feel they have a reward in terms of reputation, in terms of holding a small community of people. We had problems with the snow in Bologna, of course. We don't have your winters.
You don't know what was snow problem.
Exactly. But when it starts snowing, Bologna gets stuck. And we asked people to provide photos about the situation in the city. We had 1,000 photos in 2 days. This is something that if you do it in old media, it takes you 1 year of journalists to go around and to see the situation. So we had a snapshot about the situation in 2 days. This is the power of social network. You have to use it properly. And I don't think that you need a lot of resources to manage it. You have to open your administration and not be scared of it. If you're not, and I showed you, open to lose control on some information, you won't ever do it.
That's a question
of trust.
Trust, yeah.
There's
mutual trust.
There's a great quote that we might want to wrap up on that actually jolted me out of bed on a Sunday morning, and I'm not a morning person. And it was someone on Radio 4, he just said, the 20th century is a terrible time for control freaks. The 21st century is a terrible time for control freaks. And all of the argument, we opened the web, I remember 3 years ago on eCitizen, well, if we open the websites and let citizens comment, what if they said something we don't want to hear? But you know, that's the new world. And mm-hmm. people are grown-ups now, and they read things on Facebook mm-hmm. that are unpleasant, and they delete them. And the community actually gangs mm-hmm. up on the mm-hmm. people that abuse mm-hmm. the privilege of openness. And it's the politicians, not the civil servants, in my professional experience, it's the politicians mm-hmm. that are behind on mm-hmm. the trend toward openness and the idea that they're going to be left behind if they don't. What Bologna's doing is where everybody will be in 5 years. It will be like, of course we do it on Facebook. Why would we build our own CRMs behind, especially with the economic crisis? But I love the quote, the 21st century is a terrible time for control freaks.
Yeah, the most exciting idea what I was getting from this session was that cities do not need to build the mobile applications. We need to build the templates of the mobile applications, and citizens themselves can already bind the data and finalize the application. So I think it's a really great idea. I'd like to thank our presenters, Julia, Antti, Christina, Giovanni and Thomas, for your excellent presentation and encouraging discussion. So we are now empowered with new ideas, and then going back to our municipalities and regions, probably presenting the ideas to our mayors and our bosses, and when we are kicked off from the office and told that you do not have any money, but we have still ideas how to do it either without money. So I hope this session empowered you. Thanks you very much for the presenters. Thank you for active participation and debate. The session is closed and lunch is served. Thank you.